Hey, what's up everybody? In this video, I'm going to do some financial statement analysis, going to use an intrinsic valuation model, and try and come up with a fair value for Salesforce. If you're new to the channel, my name is Dan. I do a lot of stock analysis on this channel. If you're into that, hit that subscribe button and check out more stock analyses. All right, let's get into it. All right, so if you guys don't know about Salesforce, they're the number one customer resource management company, which means they pretty much help other companies manage their customers. They also own Tableau. If you haven't used Tableau at work, it's freaking awesome. It's a great way to make charts and graphs. So here's the deal. Here's how the revenue breaks down. You've got the Sales Cloud there in blue. And these are tools that they use to help businesses target customers better. You've got Service Cloud in red there, 28% of revenue. And that offers better customer support. 28% of the revenue comes from their Salesforce platform and other stuff. That includes Tableau, Einstein Analytics, and things of that nature. The remaining 15% of their revenue comes from marketing and commerce cloud. This is where they help people with their digital marketing. So as far as where they make their money, it's mostly in the Americas, about 70% of it from there, 20% from Europe, and just under 10% from the Asia Pacific region. So here I'm looking at their income statements for the past 5 or 6 years. And as you can see, they were reporting losses up until 2017 when they actually started making profits. Their profitability really took a huge leap in the most recent trailing 12-month period, as you can see there. Okay, so what I've done here is taken every number in each income statement and divided it by the revenue in that income statement. So everything is a percentage of revenue. So what you can see here is that this company turned profitable around 2017, and look at their margins, net income divided by revenue, that's net income margin, right? That has absolutely jumped up to 17.5% in the most recent period. And that's really why investors are so excited about this company. Can that grow even further? I say yes, because when you look at a lot of their costs, SG&A expense, R&D expense, you know, both of these costs are somewhat fixed. They're not going to change that much when the company has more revenue. Therefore, as a percentage of revenue, they're going to be going down, and I expect the margins to be going up. Here is a quick look at their balance sheet. They're very under-levered there with a liabilities-to-assets ratio of about 30%. The current ratio, which is current assets divided by current liabilities, is 1.22, which is just fine. No issues there. You can cover your current liabilities with your current assets. Quick ratio is just the same because they have no inventory. Interest coverage ratio is rather dangerous, though, 2.27. The money they bring in can only cover their interest expense 2.27 times. Very risky. If they're not able to grow their earnings, they're going to be in a tight spot. Luckily, they are forecasted to be growing their earnings. 74.7% of their assets are long-term assets. They've made some pretty heavy investments there, but I don't expect them to be adding to those long-term assets. I expect them to leverage economies of scale as they grow. Okay guys, so at this point in the video, I normally use a free cash flow to equity model to figure out what is the fair value of like Salesforce. That's going to be pretty hard in this situation. This is going to be one of the trickiest valuations that I've done so far. The reason is Salesforce really doesn't have a lot of history to go on. They really were losing money for years, and they've only recently turned the corner. They're starting to make money. What I have to do is kind of have a vision of what they're going to become. In terms of, you know, how much revenue they're going to be able to generate, I got to look at the size of the market. Then I have to look at some of their competitors and say, okay, what kind of rates of return are their competitors earning? I can't expect to earn better than that. We're going to have to get an average of their competitors. And then I have to say, okay, when will Salesforce be earning that kind of rate of return? They're certainly not earning it right now. And I kind of have to develop a path for them to get there. And so let's look at a big spreadsheet and let's get down to it. Okay, so what I've done here is I've looked at a few competitors, Adobe and Intuit, and I've looked at their net income margins, which are about 40% for Adobe, 25% for Intuit. And so what I've done is kind of, I've used 30%. I'm going to say, okay, Salesforce is eventually going to produce 30% margins. And this is kind of the path on how they get there. So I have this most recent year as the base year. And in that year, I have their margins, their net income, how much the revenue grew by, and how much they've reinvested and everything. What I'm then going to do is just to say, okay, revenue is going to grow at about 22% per year, which is the forecast we have when we look at seekingalpha.com. After 5 years, I'm going to assume additional growth rate of 10% per year for the next 5 years after that. And after that, they can grow at, you know, say 2% per year in perpetuity. If I plug in those assumptions, these are the stream of free cash flows to equity that I get. And yes, they are negative for the next couple of years because I do expect the company to reinvest a lot of their net income back into the company. So here's what it looks like. You can see years 1 through 10, you got the free cash flow to equity. I'm discounting it back to present value using an 8% growth rate. 8% may seem high, but this company has a lot of uncertainty right now. I'm going to stay conservative with that. And finally, you add it all together. You got the raw cash available on the company's balance sheet. And this in terms of millions of dollars, that's about $9.4 billion. You've got the present value of the free cash flows for the next 10 years, about $50 billion. And you have the present value of the terminal value, you know, every year after the 10th year, add it all up. You're assuming, you know, the company can just keep growing after that at like, you know, 2% a year. You get about $163 billion. So in total, there's your value in millions. And as far as per share, this analysis indicates the company would be worth $244.78 per share. You can kind of see the breakdown of value in this graph over here. And what this graph really tells you should not be that surprising. For a growth company, there's very little value in their current operating assets. You know, you've got the present value of the next 10 years is 23% of our value, and 73% of it ends up in that terminal value. So when you buy these growth companies, you're definitely betting on the future, and that makes it riskier. That's why I use the higher discount rate. One last piece of information is the insider trading activity. The insiders would include board of directors and the top executives, and you can bet they know a little bit more than we do about the company's future. So, okay, last 3 months, you've got nobody buying, 65 people selling, or 65 transactions selling. Could be the same person multiple times. And as far as the number of shares involved, you got zero buys and over 500,000 shares sold. In the last 12 months, it's also pretty abysmal there with nobody really buying. And so this, you know, overall is a pretty negative indicator about the future prospects of the company, at least in the near term. All right, guys, so let's put it all together. Here are my final thoughts. My first thought is to like that video. Hit that like button. Helps me a lot. Thank you. My second thought is this. Salesforce is very exciting because they're growing their revenues and they're growing in profitability. So, you know, when we look at those valuation multiples like PE ratio, you know, they could be very misleading. This company could be great. But when I plug in my best estimates about how things are going to unfold, I see a company with a fair value that is very close to where the stock is trading at right now. And so for me, it's not a good enough of a buffer and not a good enough of a margin of safety for me to want to buy. And the other point is that the insider sales data is absolutely abysmal. No one's buying, everyone's selling. That's not a good sign. So I generally wouldn't buy anyway when I see that big of a signal there. But I'm definitely not buying here. You know, when I estimate the value of a company like Salesforce, you got to understand that there's a lot more uncertainty in that valuation compared to when I estimate the value of, say, the 3M company or Visa or Bank of America. You know, these companies are very stable, got a long operating history for me to draw on to make my forecasts. And so whatever value I come up with for those companies, it's pretty darn close to what the value probably is most of the time. For Salesforce, you know, I have to forecast a lot of things that we don't know about. So even though the value that I got out of my model was higher than what the stock is selling for today, it's not higher by enough for me to want to jump in. So I'm personally going to pass. You know, I could be wrong. Definitely let me know what you think in the comments below. Thank you for watching.